Tilt going through business.
That's what they give out today. Just a small repetition, why we use the tilt geometry. You know that Fourier transformation of an image of a Kluge crystal is spots in the Fourier transformation. And you have a 3D crystal, and it triggers a lot of the 3D Fourier space has spots in 3D. And when they record an X-ray diffraction pattern at some slightly bent section through this 3D Fourier space, and the Ewald sphere somewhere here. You know, the 3D transformation of the 2D crystal has lattice lines. Because we have a periodicity in X and Y that gives in X and Y some periodic spots. But in the Z direction, there's just one membrane, there's nothing, and then one membrane is nothing. And that gives a continuous density in Z direction. And this is why we have in the 3D Fourier space these lattice lines. And our task is to populate these lattice lines in Fourier space, meaning amplitudes and phases, with numbers. And when we have collected all these numbers, we have our data set, and do a back transformation, have the structure of our membrane. And we do this, as you know, by tilting our sample in the microscope, taking photos like this shadow here. Here's the projection image. When you tilt the sample, the projection is compressed in one direction. We calculate the Fourier transformation of our image and put it in the 3D Fourier space as a tilted plane that runs through the center, like this here. So each Fourier transformation of this goes into the center. And by using tilt angles up to 70 degrees, as Tom showed us yesterday, we can populate the lattice lines everywhere except in this missing cone. And every one Fourier transformation gives one section of information here to populate these numbers. And in the missing cone, you have no information. This is why the resolution in the Z direction is worse, which is one of the reasons why horizontal loops are not that well resolved, besides distortion. So in order to be able to do this, we need to know the tilt geometry exactly. And the tilt geometry is a complicated thing, and it needs to be described by where's the tilt axis and how much tilt do we have. And so the definition of the tilt geometry is something really nasty. And in the MRC software, and it also makes sense, this is defined by five variables. And the first one is called tilt axis, TLT axis. And it answers the question, where is the tilt axis in the image? And it's a very simple thing. If you have your negative of a tilted sample, the tilt axis is the line where the focus does not change. So if you have a laser diffractometer and you move your negative there left and right along this line, then the ton ring will not change the diameter. That's the position of the tilt axis. And the definition, the sign of the tilt axis variable in the RC software is the angle from the x-axis, horizontal here, to the tilt axis. So in this case, the angle would be 150 degrees from the x-axis to the tilt axis, or minus 40 degrees, both would be possible. You can use either one or the other. From the x-axis to the tilt axis. Positive is always, in mathematical positive sense, is always counterclockwise. So from x-axis to here is positive number. The second variable is tilt ang, TLT ang. How much tilt was there? It's trivial, the angle, the tilt angle of the sample. The sign is so when you have stronger underfocus at the top and less underfocus at the bottom, then tilt ang is positive. And that is the definition. There are some exception rules what happens when the tilt axis is perfectly vertical. That's the detail that's in the handle.
I mean, just a question, MLC programs. That was wrong in the definition of the program, right?
But there was what?
The definition in the MC program was actually wrong when you go into the head of, and they do it according to what they say, they actually get the mirror to the instructions.
So, the handout is, I once got into this nightmare of trouble with that and sent an email to Stuart Henderson and begged for help. He wrote a long one-page answer back, and the central block of that is in the handout. And that's the definition we use since. It was an email in June 2000, and it's in the abstract that you have in your handouts. I don't know what is in the headers. tilt axis is the angle from the tilt axis to A star. I think I should do this here and then look at the header and then tell you later if this was wrong or right, but this is how you use it. So if you have a crystal, you have to define where the first vector and the second lattice vector is of your crystal. So the first vector here would be A star. A is in real space, A star is in 2D space, the first axis. And the angle between this A star and the tilt axis is tilt axa. That is from the tilt axis, here for example, to A star. In this case, it would be a positive angle of 50 degrees. And the tilt axis goes down, A star goes slightly higher up. If you imagine this vector would sit in the center, that is plus 15 degrees or something. So this is all on the negative. And now the coordinate system of the sample in the vacuum of the microscope is slightly different. So how much tilt was there is tangled now. It's the tilt angle of the sample, but in the vacuum in the microscope. And this is the same magnitude as tilt angle, but the sign may be different. So positive or negative. And the sign of tangle is the same as tilt angle, but it's inverted if the A star is above the tilt axis, which is in this case true, or it depends on the sign of tilt axa. So if tilt axa is negative, then this is also inverted again. And if the handedness of the lattice assignment is a left-handed lattice, then this is also inverted again. So you multiply the tilt angle value with minus one for each of these occurrences, if one of these conditions is true. So if two are true, then it's the same sign, and if three are true, then it's even the opposite sign. And then the last value is taxa, and that answers the question, how is the crystal oriented in the 3D plane? This is the angle from the tilt axis to A star on the sample. The angle from the tilt axis to A star on the film is tilt axa, and here this is taxa. These are very similar values. In an untilted image, they are the same, both zero, but in a tilted image, they are different because of the projection. And the projection distorts your image versus how the space is viewed. So if you have a real space, a taxa of 45 degrees in your projection, that would be smaller, slightly smaller. The first three values concern your negative, the last two values concern your sample, and only the last two values, taxa and tangle, are important for your merging. This is the only thing that is required for oracle B. Richard Henderson wrote, tilt axis, tilt angle, tilt axa only concern your image, nobody wants them. Only axa and tangle is what you need. Five numbers, how are they determined? You can determine them by four different ways, at least that's what I have seen so far. The first would be from the defocus and the negative, positive and negative here. We use the 2DX software, Nico's program CTF Fine, still in the version 2. He has a version 3, which is better. But version 2 can just measure the focus. So what we do is we measure the focus in a little pile in the center, 8,000 angstroms under focus, and then in other positions on the negative, in 7x7 positions, and then get a field of defocus values. And these defocus values from 12,000 angstroms down to 5,000 angstroms, defocus in this case here, 7x7 positions on the negative, can show you the tilt geometry. In this case, the tilt axis would be somewhere here, and this is stronger under focus, this is weaker under focus, so that defines your tilt geometry. And from this measurement of defocus values, you can define these values. But you can also plot this in Excel and try to estimate how flat your carbon film is. And it's not difficult to extend these 49 positions to more if you really want to measure the focuses over the carbon film. How important is that to get that just accurate? The tilt geometry needs to be accurate, but it can be refined in other positions.
And just a word of caution, if you do it this way, make sure the results you get make sense. Because I was trying to align a negative stain tomographic series using this tilt geometry determination, and it just blew up. Nico and I could not figure out why it didn't work. you just got absurd answers for some reason. So always take at least this approach with a grain of salt. Now, I mean, it obviously works wonderfully a lot of the time, but I know one example where not a single film made sense.
This CPF find, for example, has no chance to measure something if you're on the text label. And there's no tolerance, so CPF find cannot find something, and then these values will suddenly be just zero. And the algorithm we use in QBX tries to fit a plane and then tries to recognize outliers and throws them out of the set, and then with the remaining 47 measurements tries to fit a plane again and tries to identify outliers from then on, and this is in 1,000 cycles, always throwing out outliers that are more than 3 times standard deviation off from the predicted position where it should be with the current estimate for the driven plane. And there it tries to iteratively try to find a tilted plane even despite outliers. The CPF find fails, for example, because you're on the text view. And then from the defocus, you could populate these 5 numbers with your filter on the tree. And we have written some little program that translates this here into the 5 values. The last 2 make only sense once you have the letters, but in the beginning you wouldn't have them, so that they would be just senseless. But in the second time you run the program, then all 5 should make sense. The next way to look at the tilt geometry is using David Agar's tilt program that looks at the lattice vectors that you have in your image and compares those vectors with how the lattice vectors should be given the real space that you have about information that you have about your sample, for example. But you already see, we know it's 62 by 62 angstroms, the 2 lattices and 120 degrees angle between them. And now if you index your Fourier transformation spots, you come up with some other vectors, and if you calculate this all in, the magnification, the pixel size, and all, you can calculate the distortions, and from the distortions, calculate back to the tilt geometry. That's very precise at high tilt angles, but not so at low tilt angles. And you get the high tilt geometry quite precise, except for the sign, because there's in projection no difference between up tilt and down tilt, both are distorted in the same way. So what 2DX does, it first takes this to get an estimate about the tilt geometry using this here, and then looks at the lattice distortion, and if the angle is higher than 30 degrees, accepts this here as the better answer and uses the sign for the tilt angle of what the first defocus information is.
Sorry, another question. What is the definition how you have to how do you have to scan the negative?
That's so X has to be horizontal and Y has to be upwards.
And the tilt axis can be either way?
And the tilt axis can be anywhere. Usually the tilt axis with Henderson is horizontal, which is not ideal because then you have a lot of defocus here and very little defocus here. So you would have less defocus gradient if you would have the tilt axis vertical on a rectangular negative. If there must be software, the tilt axis is precisely 90 degrees vertical, so from x-axis the tilt axis is exactly 90.0 degrees, then there is an exception description what happens to the sign. And so there's in the software an exception, and this is all in the end of the thing. The third way to get the tilt geometry is from the spot splitting. When you have a Fourier transformation of a crystal that shows spots, if the crystal is tilted, the spots are splitted, and we will speak tomorrow morning about this, why and how they are split into pairs of 2. And the amount of spot splitting can be fitted by the TP Refine program. The TP Refine program looks at these spot splitting phenomena and tries to adjust the tilt geometry so that the spot splitting is exactly what would fit to the geometry. That's TP Refine, and using the spot splitting can also refine the tilt geometry. And the last way to refine the tilt geometry, only to refine this, is by comparing the final data set, the final projection map, with your 3D volume, if you have one. So this is done by Oracle D. Oracle D does not know about the carbon form, but can refine Huxley and Tango, the last 2 values. That only works obviously if you have a volume, and then it just tries to see here at which angle this new data set will fit best to your volume. those are the four ways to determine the field geometry, and each time the field geometry is defined by five numbers. And you can just put these five numbers next to each other in such a table and compare them and see if numbers agree or not. So that's a nightmarish thing in the beginning. So our approach in 2DX would be to try to encapsulate the whole thing into one software. I hope it works, but it may be buggy. And if there's bugs, then I hope we can just sort it out and put it once in some code that is open accessible in simple C shell scripts or using the input of David Elgert or so, and then never think about it again. Yeah, like if an X-ray crystallographer goes with an AMD crystal to the synchrotron in Berkeley and puts the crystal in, and 30 minutes later has the 3D reconstruction on the screen, they did not bother about tilt geometry in 30 minutes. So the whole thing is done, and I think we can do the same. What we need is tilt geometry listed in five numbers in four columns, which is down here. This is the 2DX interface, and Brian will explain the details later. And we can run these things, first looking at the defocus, populate this field, central defocus, and then in the tiles, 7x7, how much defocus there is. From 9,000 angstrom defocus to 6,000, so the tilt axis would in this case be somewhere here. And then these five numbers are populated here. And the next step would be to determine the lattice, and from then again, using the lattice distortions, PM tilt, again determine the tilt geometry, which gives again five numbers here. And then down in the status field, you can just compare and say, well, what did the defocus give us numbers, what did the lattice distortion give us numbers? And if something goes wrong, you can hopefully see it here immediately. But in many cases, I hope you just can put it there and never spend time with it again. Yeah, it's all at once for good. And it's a nightmarish time. And when we were in Basel, Andreas Schenk and I, we had nightmares with them on ground like this. And if there's bugs, you just need to tell everybody, especially us, and we try to sort it out and then forget about it. Yeah. It's a simple thing. The thing is still there. And the rest is technical detail that we, as biologists, should not spend our time with. We have more tricky things to do than thinking about five numbers that are stupid. So, Beaver's program here is nice. So, if you go to this here, it calculates the. So, at first we get these tiles, which are these here. This is from one spot scan image, actually from Janet Wong. These 7x7 tiles on the image. Yeah. They are these cutout tiles with their numbers. And you can look through them. This is a little preview. And then, when Nico's program CTF-Fine runs over them, it calculates the Fourier transformation where you see Phong rings, and then it simulates Phong rings on the other side and compares them with cross-correlation and tries to do the simulation so that this and this half correspond well to each other. And the output is a little test image that we have here. You can just, if you go over the 7x7 tiles, you can see how the Phong rings breathe if you go along this line by line. By just scanning through this, you can quickly check if Nico's program did a reasonable job or not. And the tone rings in the measured data on the right side, on the left side, they breathe in the same way. So these values are probably okay, and so the field geometry hopefully is true within some precision limits. Which is, if the magnification is wrong, then the tilt angle magnitude is wrong, for example. The magnification, you start with 50,000. If it's 52,000, because the magnification is slightly off due to defocus or so, then this is not precise, but at least it's roughly right, and it helps us later to find the lattice, and then you can use the lattice EM tilt output, which is better. So going to the lattice here, that would again determine the time. So the next step would be the lattice. From the lattice, again, populate these numbers. So we have this automatic lattice determination, which probably works in 90% of the image cases. And once you have this, EM tilt calculates again the numbers here. So, and then you can try to check this. And for this, we have this evaluate lattice script here, where the lattice that we have as reciprocal lattice in Fourier space is compared with the real space information about your letter is Janice Crystal, as she wrote to us, for 91.7 angstrom first fairness factor, 89.7 the second, and there was 114.5 angstrom degrees angle between the two vectors. These here, and if you know the magnification of the pixel size, should correspond to reciprocal to the reciprocal letters that you have in Fourier space. And this evaluate letter script checks all this. So if you run it, you get some output here, but you can also at this point then change your letters, for example, double the Fourier space letters in one direction or half it, or you can rotate the letters around, or so you just change the handle letters and do all kinds of permutations with the letters, and then run this script, you get an output here, and the output in this case tries to compare all these values and says, well, the given reciprocal letters that is in the Fourier space will correspond to these numbers here, 88 angstrom in one direction, 69 in the other, and 126 degrees between the vectors. These numbers are slightly different than what Janet gave us, so probably the handedness is wrong, or the permutation in Fourier space is wrong. You can just play around with this permutation and see if these numbers correspond to what you know about your sample. Change the handedness. Each time I run this, I change the handedness of the reciprocal vector.
Yes, but
the reciprocal
engines. Not just two, but six possibilities.
We have six, yes. And the other you get if you change, if you rotate the letters, for example. So if you go to Fourier space, yeah, this is the letters, and red is the first vector. This is the first vector, and this is the second. And so you can switch the handedness, and then you can rotate them around from here to there to there, and just see which assignment gives best. And these are the six possibilities you're speaking about. And we can scan these six by just each time here rotating it. And then each time I rotate it, I get different numbers here for A and B and the angle. And I do this until these three numbers correspond to what you gave us. And this way I can quickly scan. Scan all these different combinations until I find the one combination that fits best. So, yeah, so maybe something like this. Maybe also, I'm not sure if this is an example of that, as well as a square one. But this is how we like this to do this, yeah? Two permutations here.
Another question. How do you define, are there any definitions that you have to vary the sort of vectors?
Yeah, so usually you need a right-handed lattice. The right-handed means counterclockwise, the first vector goes here and the second vector comes in here. That's the right-handed lattice.
So the first vector has to go down.
So I think that ideally both vectors are on the right side, but that's not always possible. So in principle, they just need to be in counterclockwise order to have a right-handed lattice. This would be a left-handed lattice, because if you go this way, you first see the second and then the first. So this is left-handed. And this should be plotted here, left-handed lattice. Yeah, here. It says here left-handed lattice. Sometimes you need it. If you have a crystal that is not a mirror symmetry, it can fall down this way or that way on the grid. And if you want to merge different images, then you may need to have one hand lattice left hand, and on another image, you need the right hand. And in this crystal, that was the case, and by using these permutations, you can just play around manually so far only until these numbers fit.
And how do you start finding the spotlets? I mean, when you start indexing.
So it says here, don't forget to redo the spot list. If you change the letters, then you would have to change to rename all the spots in the spot list, because the same spot suddenly has different coordinates. here there would be just this option to just redo the spot list, which you do by clicking here and clicking there, and then you have redone the spot list. Okay, sorry, crashed. I don't have the Xamarin Enterprise file at the moment because I didn't run all the rest. So. I have only 5 minutes left. I think I'm at the end anyway. Yesterday we spoke about Matron, and I just have this slide and the handout, which probably is there, or I think it is there, or will be there later. It goes from here to there, just to have this one figure at the handout. It's just in addition to yesterday's. Otherwise, I'm done.
So what I meant to ask was, when you have your query transform, you want to start identifying where the spots are and how to index them. How do you start? Do you start off identifying where, you know, 0, 1, and 1, 0 points are, or does it do that automatically?
Can't do it automatically yet. So we have lattice determination automatically, and we are writing a paper about that. We have two different algorithms. One is information about the crystal unit cell and information and all this. This Yang-Yang program, and Brian's version does not need this. But Brian's version may go wrong if you have systematic absences. So we have these two algorithms, and the first one is running here, and the second one will go out there soon. You can also do it by hand. By hand, you would do it manually. I think Brian may show this in a bit practical later, where you click on plugin index, you click on different spots and get their names, and then say, and so on. And I'll make a lattice out of them.
But if you have a new crystal, you don't have to do it yourself. Can you still do it automatically?
But Brian's software, yes. So here, if you don't know, there's this lattice refinement mode. There should be something that we should have.
I'll show that.
Okay, good. So, Brian.
Yeah?
I have a specific question for electron diffraction pattern. We need to extract the two geometry for
you need that too, and 2DX cannot deal with the fraction so far, and we can wait for answers for the moment. It's the same 5 numbers, I think. In each case, he will speak about that fraction. So, but you need to know this in order to put it in the 3D space, to match the data.
So for the indexing, this is taking to possible symmetry into account to choose the A star, B star direction, or is it just sort of the smallest?
So far, it does not consider symmetry. So what this automatic lattice determination does is calculates a test lattice and rotates it around and tries to see when it snaps in. It does not determine symmetry at that point. So, for symmetry, you can use David Eggert's power space problem, which is the term space for condition. We have to do this manually at the moment. Yes.